Doing's moving through 22 verses of this 18th chapter. We're getting to the conclusion of Paul's second missionary journey. And Lord's willing, next Wednesday night, we'll move into the third missionary journey. Verse 22, 23 of the same chapter, we'll get started in the third missionary journey. It starts there and we'll continue along in it. But we'll just go down through verse number 22 tonight, getting in the conclusion of this missionary journey. Can you see that? Can you see it pretty good? We're just in a little area tonight, around Athens and Corinth, Ephesus, and back down to, on the return trip back to Jerusalem, Antioch, Caesarea. Let's read these first 17 verses, okay, in chapter 18. You can stand if you want to. We'll read 17, then we'll go back and we'll talk to you a little about it and finish out the chapter then as well. The Bible said, after these things, Paul departed from Athens, and of course that's where we were last week in the sermon there on Mars Hill that Paul presented. And he's leaving there, and he came to Corinth and found a certain Jew named Aquila, born in Pontus, lately come from Italy with his wife Priscilla, because he commanded all Jews to depart from Rome and came unto them. And because he was of the same craft, he abode with them and wrought, for by their occupation they were tent makers. And he reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath and persuaded the Jews and the Greeks. And when Silas and Timotheus were come from Macedonia, Paul was pressed in the spirit and testified to the Jews that Jesus was Christ. And when they opposed themselves and blasphemed, he shook his raiment and said unto them, your blood be upon your own heads. I am clean. From henceforth I will go unto the Gentiles. And he departed thence and entered into a certain man's house named Justus, one that worshipped God, whose house joined hard to the synagogue. And Crispus, the chief ruler of the synagogue, believed on the Lord with all his house, and many of the Corinthians hearing believed and were baptized. Then spake the Lord to Paul in the night by a vision, be not afraid, but speak and hold not thy peace, for I am with thee. No man shall set on thee to hurt thee, for I have much people in this city. Boy, you got a promise like that, you can go for it, can't you? And Paul had one. And he continued there a year and 6 months, teaching the word of God among them. And when Gallio was the deputy of Achaia, the Jews made insurrection with one accord against Paul and brought him to the judgment seat, saying, this fellow persuaded men to worship God contrary to the law. And when Paul was now about to open his mouth, Gallio said to the Jews, if it were a matter of wrong or wicked lewdness, O ye Jews, reason would I that I should bear with you. But if it be a question of words and names or of your law, look ye to it, for I will be no judge of such matters. And he drave them from the judgment seat. Then all the Greeks took Sothenias, the chief ruler of the synagogue, and beat him before the judgment seat, and Gallio cared for none of those things. Boy, he had a real heart about him, didn't he? Father, help us tonight and touch our hearts with your word, we pray in Jesus' name, and amen.
Amen.
All right, they're leaving out of Athens, and they come to Corinth. That's just a little ways, not very far down the road, actually. The city of Corinth was probably the most wicked city of that day. I mean, you're talking about things going on at Corinth. They had about as much wickedness as you could think of. Not like the America we live in today. It was the political and commercial center of Greece. It surpassed Athens in importance. It had a great reputation for wickedness and immorality. If you took Corinth and took something out of the United States of America and said, this is like Corinth, Corinth would have been the Hollywood and the Las Vegas that we have here in this country that was there in the Roman Empire. So they had a lot that was wicked and just bad and immorality and immoral acts that were going on in Corinth. They actually had a temple to Aphrodite, which was the goddess of love and war, and it had been built on a large hill up behind the city. And in this popular religion that was there in Corinth, people worshiped the goddess by giving money to the temple, and listen to this, and taking part in sexual acts with male and female prostitutes. You know, when I was sitting and just going over that, I thought this. If you want a religion that fits what you want to believe, if you look long enough and hard enough and far enough, you'll find a religion to fit what you want. But now the truth and the gospel will set you free, and a lot of people are not looking for that. They don't desire that. But they want a religion that will satisfy and tickle their fancy, and they can say that it's some kind of religion that they're associated with when it's absolutely no good whatsoever. And there's enough religions in this world. Religion sending people to hell. Do you know that? Religion will do that. Paul found Corinth to be a challenge. Now, when you've got that much wickedness going on in one place, there's a challenge there. And it's a great ministry opportunity. I think in our lifetime, Bob, in our time of ministry, it's always in our years, it's been a good time for ministering the gospel. But boy, it's sure a wide open door today. Look at the wickedness that's around in our country and things that, you know, we hear about that are going on around the United States and around the world are not only happening way out there now, they're coming to the smaller areas where we're living in now. So there's a great opportunity to reach people for Christ. And of course, you know, later he wrote a series of letters to the Corinthians dealing in part with the problems of immorality. And of course, you know that chapter number 3 talks about it, and on through there he talks about one having his father's wife, which was no doubt his stepmother, and the church knowing about it and doing nothing about it. And they just allowed it to go on like nothing was happening. And you know, that's where we get into when we fail to use church discipline in the house of God. We're people the thought in their mind, this must be all right. Because church not saying anything to me about it. And they know what's going on. And Paul wrote to them and he said, you can't just sweep that thing under the rug and let it go. You've got to confront it. And the reason you need to do it is to so everybody else will know that it's sin. And we're not going to play around with sin. We're going to take care of it. And we're going to put them, if they won't listen, then we're going to put them out of the church as church discipline. And that's to show them that they're wrong and in hopes that they'll turn their life around and get back right with the Lord. See, when you go by church discipline, it's never because you're angry or mad at people. It's to let them see the sinfulness that they're in. And by doing that, you're praying that their eyes might be open and they'll see what they're doing that's wrong and repent of that sin and get back right with the Lord. Now, you know what the church is supposed to do when they do that? Yeah. We're supposed to welcome them back into the fellowship of the body of believers. So that shows you we shouldn't have had a negative or a bitter attitude about it when we was using discipline to begin with. So he writes a series of letters to the Corinthians dealing part of the problems of immorality. We've got, of course, 1st and 2nd Corinthians. There are two of those letters. There's some of the Corinthians letters that were lost letters. If you'll remember, there's some writing in Scripture, and he refers, and Paul's writing to another letter that's not included in the canon of the Bible, the Word of God. So there's some lost letters, or at least there's some letters that were written to the Corinthian church that didn't make it into what we call the Bible. So wherever they're at, but he wrote more than just the two letters. Here Paul finds a Jew named Aquila, and his wife Priscilla, and they were from Rome, and the Bible said because they had been forced to leave because of the Emperor Claudius, and they couldn't stay there. Aquila was also a tent maker, and I thought this, wouldn't you like to take and sew this together and make a tent? It's cutting and sewing the woven cloth of goat's hair into tents. How many of you want a job doing that? I don't want one. Do you, Bob? I think I'll pass on that. Many tents were used to house soldiers, and so the tents that they would make may have been sold to the Roman army. And as being a tent maker, Paul was able to go wherever God led him, and he was always able to carry his livelihood right along with him. He was an itinerant preacher. He'd work the day, preach at night, and he'd make tents, and they'd sell those tents, and he took care of himself, and he preached the word of God. And boy, isn't it amazing how God can just work things out for the individual that wants to do a service and a work for the Lord. And God certainly did in the life of Paul. And so another thing about tent maker in the Greek, it was also used to describe leather work. So, you know, when it says tent maker, we all instantly envision getting our minds about the tent. I think that's probably primarily what Paul did. But it could have had to do with some leather work that he was doing. But anyway, he had a trade that took care of him and provided for his means. And he was able to travel like that he did and take the gospel to different regions and different areas. Boy, that's wonderful to be able to do that. And Paul did it. So Paul spoke each Sabbath, the Bible says, in the synagogue. And while in Corinth, Paul's joined by Silas and, the Bible said, Timotheus or Timothy. And even though he experienced a great deal of success here in Corinth, the Jews again opposed him. Satan's not going to just let you away alone while you're trying to do a work for the Lord. He'll oppose you in every way possible. And he opposed Paul. But you know what Paul did? He just kept on going. And it appears, when I look at verse 6, look at that verse there, that it was here at Corinth that Paul made his final break with the Jews. He states in this verse that in the future he's going to deliver the message to the Gentiles. He said, you know, your blood be upon your own heads, not upon me. I've delivered you the gospel and you would not listen. You didn't adhere to it, so you're on your own. And basically, I believe Paul told the Jews, I've done all that I can do for you. I can't do any more. You know, I think there's a time that perhaps God gets that way with individuals. He brings conviction and brings conviction and brings conviction, and they just continue going, and they get to a point that God says, I've done all I can do. I can do no more. You're on your own. And that's a sad state to get in when you're there. Verse 7, after stating that he'd no longer take the gospel message to the Jews, the Bible says he goes into the house of justice, whose house was next to the synagogue, and there was a man by the name of Crispus. He was the chief ruler of the synagogue. And the Bible said that his entire household received Christ. And the conversion of Crispus seemed to add a new spark in the ministry of Paul, because look at the end of verse 8. Not only did Crispus come to know the Lord, not only did his household come to know the Lord, but the Bible said at the end of verse 8, he says, and many of the Corinthians hearing believed and were baptized. Amen. So boy, I'll tell you, it sparked in Crispus, went to his household, and other Corinthians believed in the Lord and accepted Christ as their Savior. Now, in verses 9 and 10, he gets a vision. And Christ tells Paul that he's got many people there in Corinth. I hope you caught that when we was reading through. He had some saved people in Corinth. Everybody hadn't been given over to immorality and idolatry and false religions. There were still people that loved God. And the Lord said to Paul, I've still got a few down there. You know, there's still those elect of God that are still in here fighting the good fight of faith and worshiping the Lord. Folks like you that are dedicated to the work of the Lord here on Wednesday morning. Deb said today, made a statement, and she said this. We went over to the vet at Sparta. That's where we go, because that's where we was for so long. She's off today, and what a day to spend your birthday going to the vet's office. Then you can't even go inside, get there and have to call them, and they come out and get your pet and take the pet in. Now, ain't that something? But we're coming back, and I don't know if it's a song or what, but Deb looked at me and she said, you know, we've come too far to turn back now. And I thought, man, how true that is. I'm getting closer to leaving this world and going to a better land. And we've come way too far to ever think about turning back now. The best is yet to come, amen? So sometimes we may feel all alone in this life. We may feel like we're the ones being persecuted. We may feel like Elijah, that we're the only one left. But be reminded, Elijah was, hey, I've still got 7,000. They've not bowed their knee to old Baal. I've still got some that loves the Lord. Listen, folks, we're not the only ones. There's still a remnant. God's got his chosen ones that are still worshiping him and serving him. So now for the next year and a half, Paul ministers there in Corinth. And others who became Christians in Corinth, and you can look at this, Phoebe, in Romans 16:1, Tertius in Romans 16:22, Erastus, all these about in Rome. Romans 16:23, if you get down through there, you'll see a lot of them. Quartus, Chloe, Gaius, Stephanus and his household, Fortunatus, Achaicus. Boy, wouldn't you like to have some names like these? I'm glad I've got an Eddie and you've got a Bob, ain't you? I can pronounce those pretty easy. But I've read some of them, especially when you get into those genealogies. You better pray before you start reading genealogy. And listen, genealogy is important. You start from the very beginning and go through that lineage and that genealogy. It's important, every one of them that's listed in the Bible. But boy, I get about half through some of those names and I have to stop and say, Lord, help me to get on through here. And you say, I kind of like Phyllis said, how do you pronounce that? And Phyllis said, same way you do. So that's the way I pronounce a lot of it, the same way you do. But during this year and a half, Paul established a church there in Corinth, and he wrote two letters to the believers in Thessalonica while he was there at Corinth. And in those letters to Thessalonica that he wrote, he commended the believers for their loving deeds, their strong faith that they're placed in the Lord, their steadfast hope that he had. He encouraged them to stay away from immorality, and he dealt with the themes of salvation, the suffering of the saints, and of course, the second coming of Christ. And you want to get into about the second coming of Christ, get in the book of Thessalonians and read those two little books, and Paul will give you in depth and great detail about the second coming of the Lord. And the Jews were so upset over Paul's presence and message that they brought charges against him. In verse number 12, Gallio was the governor of Achaia. He came to power somewhere around 51-52 A.D. Verse 13, Paul is unjustly charged with treason. Isn't it amazing how they'll trump up accusations and charges against somebody that is living for the Lord and doing for the Lord? You remember like Daniel? They said if he's going to catch Daniel in anything, he's going to have to catch it between him and his God, or they're going to be in trouble. They weren't going to get anything against him. But they're always out to bring charges against those that are worshiping the Lord. Now, Paul wouldn't encourage an obedience to a human king other than Caesar. And he wasn't speaking against the Roman Empire. He's speaking about the eternal kingdom of Jesus Christ. Boy, that upset a lot of people. It upsets people today. You know, if you want to talk about God, that's all right, because God can be in a broad spectrum. If you want to talk about religion, talk about any religion you want to. But when you get talking about Jesus Christ, man, that's nailing that thing down. And you know why the devil opposes the name of Jesus Christ so much? Because he knows that the only way to God the Father is through Jesus Christ the Son, and that's why he don't want him preached and mentioned. So do whatever you want, just leave Jesus out of the equation, and you'll be all right. Now, verses 14 through 16, when they appeared before Gallio, he drops all the charges, and that was an important judicial decision for the spread of the gospel in the Roman Empire. In effect, Gallio was saying this: I don't understand all your terminology and your finer points of your theology. Handle the matter yourselves and don't bother me with it. In other words, get out of here. In verse 17, since Crispus, remember back over in verse 8, he'd been the leader of the synagogue. He's converted. He joined with Christians. Sothenius was chosen to take his place. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 1, there is a Sothenius. I hope that's close to right. He's mentioned, and many believe that he's the same man mentioned here. In time, he too became a convert and companion of Paul. Don't ever give up on anybody. I heard somebody say the other day about, well, it might have been us talking, Bob, about some morning. We talked about how it's a hard nut to crack sometimes. And you think, man can't do it. But isn't it amazing how God can take that life and this, that? That one that we thought was almost unreachable, God's able to reach him. The power of the Holy Spirit, listen, friend, he's still real. The power of the Holy Spirit's still real. All right, we're going to leave out of Corinth now, and we're going to head back to Jerusalem and Antioch, and we're going to go through Ephesus, which is not very far off, just a little ways on cross. Well, it is pretty good ways. And Paul, after this, tarried there yet, and I'm looking at it and still getting, well, mine doesn't show it that far. Well, yours doesn't. Yours spread out. It's good. They actually going across the edge, GNC. And, of course, I guess it is pretty good ways. It'd have to be pretty good ways across there. He tarried there yet a good while, and then took his leave of the brethren and sailed thence into Syria, and with him Priscilla and Aquila, having shorn his head and sincerely, for he had made a vow, and some feel like that's probably a Nazarite vow that Paul had taken there, and that I think that's probably what it was. And then he comes to Ephesus, and he left them there, but he himself entered into the synagogue and reasoned with the Jews. And when they desired him to tarry longer time with them, he consented not, but bade them farewell, saying, I must by all means keep this feast that cometh in Jerusalem, but I'll turn again to you if God will. And he sailed from Ephesus. And when he had landed at Caesarea and gone up and saluted the church, he went down to Antioch. So after the missionary visit in Corinth, he set sail with Aquila and Priscilla for Syria or in Antioch. And he crosses the Aegean Sea. He lands on the western shore of Asia Minor at a place called Ephesus. He writes a letter, you know, back to Ephesus called the Book of Ephesians, the Ephesian letter. He stays only 1 week, even though the Jews want him to stay longer. And I read these passages like this, and I think of all the opposition that he faces in some places, and he's kind of run out of town and forced out. Here he gets to Ephesus and they want him to stay. But he don't stay. He's got to get back to Jerusalem. And it's amazing how things work sometimes. You ever just read the Bible and stop and think, isn't it amazing how things work out? And so the reason he was in such a hurry stated in verse 21. He wanted to get back to Jerusalem for the feast. Probably Passover, could have been Pentecost, one or the other, Paul wanted to get back for. And the brief stay didn't allow any opposition. When you're only there a week, they can't drum up a whole lot of stuff, can they? That was one good thing about it. So not a lot of opposition developed. And he promises them this, that he would return. And he set sail from Ephesus to Caesarea and to Jerusalem. Verse 22 says he goes down to Jerusalem. He lands in Caesarea. He goes up to the church. Paul's fourth visit to Jerusalem after he's been converted and come to know the Lord. Luke doesn't give us any details of what Paul did in Jerusalem on this visit, except that he says he saluted or paid his respects to the church, then journeyed on to Antioch in Syria. He arrives at Antioch and he completes his second missionary journey. The length that he stayed in Antioch, it's unknown. So guess what? We don't know either. If the Bible don't tell us, we don't have a lot going, do we? And since Silas isn't heard from again after this time, it's assumed that he remained back in Jerusalem. Now, he spent 3 years on this second missionary trip. That's a lot of time, isn't it? And he had traveled approximately 2,925 miles on land and on sea. That's putting in a lot of work for the land. That's just the second journey. He's already been on one. This is the second, and he still got one to go. Boy, when he got saved on the Damascus Road, he sold out, didn't he? He went all the way. He got in wholeheartedly for the Lord. Well, let me give you these four questions. Ain't got many tonight. And then we're going to run, go out to fellowship hall, and we're going to have some refreshments. Anybody in for refreshments? Don't have any beans. That's another name. We'll have him on Old Fashioned Day. We'll have him baby. What were the names of the couple that he joined with at Corinth? Hey, that's good. Y'all listening. Tell me you don't listen. Who was the chief ruler of the synagogue who received Christ? Crispus. What'd you do? Write all these down. You're doing good. How long did Paul minister in Corinth? Year and a half. About how long had this missionary journey taken? How many miles did he go to land and sea? A lot. That's a good answer. Boy, 2,925. That's approximate. 2,925 miles. And a long journey. A lot of lives were touched. Souls saved. That's like the message on Mars Hill. You know, while there in Athens, some said he wasn't successful at Athens. But at the end of that chapter, or at the end of that message, it gives us some names. It doesn't list a bunch, but there were some that got saved because of him going there. I've always said, if one soul escapes the damnations of hell, don't tell me that was an unsuccessful ministry right there. If we preach till the Lord calls us home, and I know we've seen more converted than that, but if we only seen one, it'd be worth it all, wouldn't it? Jeremiah preached and preached and preached, and nobody listened. Noah preached and preached, nobody listened. But they kept on, did they? They kept on preaching. All right, let's stand up here and get ready to move out. How about that? Father, thank you for the service tonight. Thank you for being with us. Lord, I pray you bless our little time of fellowship together tonight. And we'll thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. And amen.
Amen.